So we'll start. My job is to, like the last balance con, the do the work of John the Baptist before Jesus Christ actually arrives. Okay, so before all the other faculty come and introduce the more advanced topics, I will just introduce the beginning concept so that everything else will fall in place. Okay, core concepts in vestibular physiology or physiology and pathology. Okay, what are the functions of the vestibular system? We start with that. Okay, we've been used to using vague terms like, okay, balance, equilibrium, balance, vertigo, and all those things. It is now time to just get into the specific so that when we know the specifics, this abnormality leads to this disease leads to this particular kind of clinical features, and this is the way to manage it. Okay, fine. The question, first question is, what is the work of the semicircular canal? What is the one work of the semicircular canal? If you have to specifically tell number one function of this semicircular canal, what it is? Measures movement for what? To serve what purpose? To stabilize vision. Okay, to stabilize vision. Why do we need to stabilize vision? Okay, what do you mean by stabilizing gaze or stabilizing vision? Thumb forward, all of you. I like this thumb experiment all the time. Okay. Thumb forward, all of you. Look at your thumb. Lights on in the hall. Look at your thumb. Bring the thumb closer to your little closer. Look at your thumb. See the nice picture of the thumb, the lines, all those things. You're getting a sharp vision. You're getting a very sharp vision. Yes. Put your left thumb together, just next to that. Look at your left thumb. Look at your left thumb. You're getting a sharp vision. Shift to your right thumb. Sharp vision. Yes. Okay. Now, when you're looking at your right thumb, try to determine how good is the vision of your left thumb. How good is the vision of the left thumb? Blurred. It is not as good as the right thumb. So, basically, what is the meaning? The meaning is, on the retina, the image falls, but only that thing that falls on the center of the fovea, within 0.5 degrees of the center of the fovea, that one is sharp. Everything else is not sharp. If an object of interest has to be sharply focused and clearly seen, the eye should remain on the object of interest irrespective of our head perturbations, which keep happening. Okay. So, if the semicircular canal has to detect head movement, it is to make sure that when my head moves right, the eye, it is to give the information to the eye to move by the same amount of degrees to the left so that the eye remains fixed. Okay, this is the function of the semicircular canal. So if somebody asks what is the function of the semicircular canal, yes, it detects motion, it detects head movement. There are many ways in which it does, but it is to drive one purpose, and that purpose is stabilize vision. Okay, so inner ear helps in vision. Next, there are three functions of the labyrinth that we need to consider. The first function was vision, stabilizing vision. The second function is postural stability. Okay, to stabilize posture, how does this is done? Stabilizing posture means you don't fall off. This is an anti-gravity function. Okay, one part of the body is laid on other part of the body, so that we maintain a anti-gravity posture without falling off. This needs a sensory limb, a motor system, and a center. The sensory limb should tell what is the earth vertical. If you don't know what is earth vertical, nothing else can tell how to stand vertical. So earth vertical is detected by the otoliths. And the third function of the labyrinthine system, which has not been recognized for a long time, which recently is getting a lot of attention, is the vestibular system is the basis for the body's internal global positioning system. What do you mean by body's internal global positioning system? You switch on your GPS on your mobile. You want to go from one place to one place. What does it, the first thing it tells? It tells where you are. Yes? It tells where you are. It tells which direction you are headed. Correct? And how far you are from your destination, how much you are traveling. Fine? That is what the GPS does. We have within our brains, in the entorhinal cortex, that area, okay, a lot of animal studies have been done. There are three different kinds of neurons. Place cells, head direction cells and grid cells. What is the meaning of a flat cell? The moment I'm in this room, the entire room is mapped. Significant places are all mapped and kept. If I go to one particular place in this room of something that is significant, unique, if one particular neuron called a place neuron for this place starts firing, I go around the room, and then if I come back to this place, that same neuron starts firing, which means our brains can come to know where exactly we are. GPS work? Yes? Okay. Then the other thing is head direction cells, or which direction you are facing. If I'm facing this direction, if one particular that head direction neuron is firing for this side, the moment I turn that direction to somewhere else, that stops. Wherever I go in the room, again, if I face that same direction, that cell fires. Okay, there is a head direction cell. And then the last one is grid cell. Grid cell is like milestones. Grid cells are like milestones. Each time you travel a meter in any direction, it fires, telling us that you have moved in that. The moment you know which direction you are facing, how much you have traveled, and map the significant places. So-and-so hotel, so-and-so this place. What else is this? Is it not the global positioning system work? Yes. So three functions of the vestibular system. Problems of the vestibular system show up as abnormalities of these three functions. Postural stability problem, gaze stability, not able to look well, see well, or the objects looking like they are moving around, whatever. Okay. Now coming to the core loss, the functions are over. Head and eyes in vestibulo-ocular reflex. Okay. All of us know that if my head moves in this direction, okay, if my head moves in this direction, the eye has to move in the opposite direction to serve the purpose of stability of vision. But it has to move in the same plane. If my head moves in this direction, eye moves in this plane, it doesn't serve the purpose. Okay, so head and eyes in vestibulo-ocular reflex, head and eye moves in the same plane, but in the opposite directions. So what exactly, if we go a little deep, eyes move in the same direction of inner ear fluid movement, eyes in the same direction as the hair cell cupula or macular deflection. We'll go to that little detail now. Okay, when you look at the inner ear, okay, when you look at the hair cell, okay, you see the hair cell here? Okay, you see the hair cell here? Is that pointer seen well? Arrow was fine. So when you look at the hair cell structure, this is a resting hair cell, okay, in the inner ear. This hair cell is the basis. This is a mechanoceptor, which is the basis of the cochlear system. This is also the basis of the semicircular canals, and this is also the basis of the function of otolith organs. But what exactly is here? There is the kinocilium, long kinocilium, and there are many stereocilia attached to one another, or a lot of tip cells. So there is 1, 2, 3, 4, and there is something called tiplings attached to one another. What exactly are these tiplings? What purpose do they serve? These tiplings are, they anchor to small molecular doors. Okay, they anchor to small molecular doors. So in the neutral position, these tiplings keep the molecular doors partially open. Okay, partially open. When the kinocilium moves in this direction, the direction in which the arrow is pointed, the tiplings pull on the stereocilia and open the doors much more wider. And when it moves in the opposite direction, the tiplings become loose and the molecular doors come shut. The way in which this is arranged is such that the doors are partially open, allow great extent of complete opening, but allow a very small amount of complete closure. Okay, What do these multicolor doors do? They allow ions to enter. I will not get into full details of which ion, what, how much. But they allow ions to enter. When ions cross membranes, action potentials get generated. Okay? Action potentials get generated, and that is how the head movement is detected. Even in a resting hair cell, which is in its neutral position, okay, a neutral position hair cell also has molecular doors open, which means even a neutral position hair cell can generate action potentials. Okay. So we saw about, okay, now if the head moves in one direction, you see that the head moves in one direction. The head moves in one direction. The inner ear fluids move in the opposite direction. The inner ear moves in the opposite direction. Head moves in one direction. Eyes move in the opposite direction. The inner ear fluid moves. You're all with me? Okay. So if the head moves in one direction, the fluid actually lags behind, but it looks like it moves in the opposite direction. Correct? Is it not the same direction in which the eye moves? So inner ear fluid movement direction and eye movement direction, is it not the same? Yes? Okay. The cupula also gets deflected. The cupula deflection side direction and the eye movement direction, is it not the same? Yes? So, the eyes, slow phase of the eye movement is always in the direction of the fluid movement of the inner ear, is always in the direction of the cupular deflection. So, just by looking at the eye movement, slow phase or fast phase, whatever, plane, the plane in which the eye is moving, by looking at that, can we deduce which semicircular canal is eliciting that response? Can we? So that is the idea of all these things. So you can just look at the eye movement. Dr. Kshitij is going to talk in detail about that. So you can look at the direction of eye movement, plane of the eye movement, and tell this eye movement relates to this semicircular canal. This other eye movement relates to this semicircular canal. This eye movement is a combination of these two semicircular canals. Like that. That is one thing. Okay? This one, compared to the semicircular canal, when it comes to the otolith organ, semicircular canal had a cupula which is the same weight as the surrounding water. It is not responsive to gravity at all. It doesn't respond to gravity. Whereas when it comes to the otolith organ has to detect gravity. What is the best way to detect gravity? Weight. Use a weight. Okay. The construction worker uses something called a plumb bob. It just hangs straight down. Okay. Always anything heavy hangs towards the, tends to sag towards the ground. So that is the principle of what happens within the inner ear. Whether God created, whether it is in evolution, whatever it is, this is an intelligent mechanism where we use something heavy to, with something heavy to find out the line of gravity. So in the inner ear, in the otolith organs, we have something heavy lying on top of these hair cells. Okay. This helps in the further discussions just to know what is the direction of orientation of the utricle and the direction of orientation of the saccule. Hand forward like this. What is the orientation? This responds to utricle or saccule? This plane corresponds to utricle or saccule? Utricle. This plane? Saccule. So this is it. Horizontally oriented is utricle. Vertically oriented is saccule. So something that is vertically oriented with something heavy in it, if it goes up, there is a relative movement. Yes. If it comes down, there is a relative movement. Yes. If it goes up forward, there is a relative movement. If it comes backward, there is a relative movement. But if it just moves like this, there is no relative movement. Yes. So saccule cannot detect this movement. Saccule can detect this movement, this movement. When you're going up a lift, coming down, when you're bobbing up and down, saccule detects. When you're going forward and backward, saccule can detect. When it comes to utricle, what all can happen? If it is the utricle like this, if you tilt to right, this will tilt this way. If you tilt backwards, this will tilt this way. Yes. If you go forward, backward, okay. But the utricle, if you go up and down, so utricle is not responsive to this movement. But utricle is respond to fore, aft, side, side. And also to tilts. It's also to tilts. Fine. So utricle can detect tilts. Again, this one is one chorus. Again, bigger sound. Utricle. This one is saccule. Though we say that the utricle and saccule are in this plane, they are not exactly in one sheet. They take a curve. Okay, when it comes to saccule, it takes a curve. Though it is in the sagittal plane, it takes a curve. Okay. The utricle also, there is a curve. There is a purpose behind it. Okay. So, all the hair cells are not in one place. Okay. So, when the body tilts to this direction or this direction, different hair cells are deflected to different levels based on how they are oriented to gravity. So they are, some places they are firing at neutral level, some sites on the inhibitory level, some sites on the excitatory level. When the body tilts or the head tilts to one direction, that map changes. Okay, you see, this was the neutral level. When I tilt, this becomes the neutral level, somewhere at around 30, what was there. So what was previously neutral level becomes the inhibited level. Okay. So, the brain has a map. From the utricular and saccular firings, the brain gets a map. Yes? You're with me? So, based on the map that the brain gets, the brain can actually make out how much the head has tilted right or left. The problem with this map is, okay, tilt also produces a deflection. Okay, when there is a tilt of the utricle, it produces a deflection. When there is a translation, there also there is a deflection. So, you see in this image, the previous image was about a tilt. This image is about a translation. Even translation produces the same kind of deflection of the hair cells. Yes? Does translation produce hair cell deflection? Just like the tilt? Now, I take the right-hand side image of this one and the right-hand side image of this one and place them side by side. I place them side by side by correcting the tilt amount only. Can you make out the right side and left side and see and tell whether there is a difference in firing or the map that the brain gets from right and left? It is the same. So, the utricle and the otolith organs themselves cannot tell the brain whether you are actually translating or you are tilting. The brain has to deduce this based on integrating the input from the semicircular canal, what exactly is happening, and the timing signals, all these things. Otherwise, utricle or saccule themselves cannot tell the brain whether somebody is tilting or translating. Whether somebody is tilting or translating. So, what is the significance of this? This is significant because of central causes of positional vertigo, where tilts are confused as translations and you get continuing nystagmus. Next concept, canal pairs are arranged in a push-pull configuration. Okay, so right horizontal, left horizontal, they are arranged in a push-pull configuration. Both of them are firing even at neutral position. Rightward head movements increases the firing rate of the right side. We saw that in the beginning, and decreases the firing rate on the left side. But though they are arranged in a push-pull configuration, we all know each semicircular canal in its own can detect head movements in both directions. Okay? Is that right? We know that this one, we know that this hair cell action potential increases in one direction, decreases in one direction. So brain knows if it is decreased, the head has moved in the one direction. If it has increased, the head has moved in another direction. Is that right? But the doors are partially open, more towards the closure side. So with some amount of movement, some amount more than a little bit of extra speed, it closes in the inhibitory direction. And how much ever increased, if you do, like, if I move my head to the right side fast, right horizontal semicircular canal, doors open, 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 open. I go on mocking the speed more and more and more. They can open more and more and more. Whereas, when I move in the opposite direction, it closes. Once it is closed, even if I make the speed more also, it can close only so much. It cannot overshoot. Okay, so though each semicircular canal can detect head movement in its excitatory and inhibitory direction, inhibition saturates. Okay, that is why we need both semicircular canals for high speeds. For low speeds, one is enough. For low speeds, one is enough. Then, for all the purposes that we go on for in the discussion, we need to know some more concepts. The semicircular canal pairs. Right horizontal and left horizontal is a horizontal pair. Okay, complementary pairs. So one gets inhibited, other gets stimulated for that particular plane. So all of you, stretch your hands forwards. This one, this is the plane of orientation of which canals? This one. See, this one is horizontal canals. This one is, or whatever, in this plane. Which canals? Anterior canals. And this plane? Posterior canals. So, this and this are complementary pairs. This is called left anterior, this is right posterior. Left anterior, right posterior. What is it called? LARP. And this is called RALP, horizontal. Three pairs of semicircular canals. As the integration happens into the brainstem and higher levels, this gets converted into other three planes. What are those? This plane is called pitch plane. This plane is called yaw plane. And this plane is called roll plane. Tell with me. Loudly. LARP, LARP. This one. RALP. All of you, chorus. RALP. Horizontal. Okay, this is semicircular canal. Okay, this one. Yaw. Loudly. This one. Yeah. This one. Pitch. This one. Roll. Loud. So now tell me, what is this? Pitch. This one. This one. This one. Now. This one. Yeah, saccule. Name of this movement? Bob. Bob. This one. Which surge? Which translation? Surge. Surge. This one. Heave. Okay? So, bob, surge, and heave. Okay? Learned a lot in 20 minutes? Last slide. Okay? About something about cerebellum. This is again important. You look at the cerebellum there. Okay. You see, there is the midline cerebellum. There is the lateral hemisphere. And when you turn over and look from the front, the cerebellum, then we have the flocculonodular lobe. Correct? We have the flocculonodular lobe. This cerebellar cortex has its corresponding deep cerebellar nuclei. Correct? For the hemisphere, the deep cerebellar nucleus is the dentate nucleus, right? And the interposed nucleus. For the vermis, you can see the fastigial nuclei, correct? For the flocculus nodulus, what is the corresponding deep cerebellar nucleus? Anybody? It is the vestibular nuclei. So, flocculus and nodulus, developmentally when you see, they developed from the vestibular nuclei. So, vestibular nuclei for functional purposes and also embryologically correspond to the deep cerebellum. They are considered as deep cerebellar nuclei. Okay, all these things will become more and more important as we go on studying the further clinical topics. Okay, with that, the initial beginning concepts have been introduced. Thank you so much.